everyone. I'm Vanessa Taholka. I present Bite Into It, a weekly technology and computing program on Triple R's community radio station. As an avid art collector and a coder, I'm delighted to have you all here to join us for the fusion of art and technology. This is the inaugural annual lecture in the Telstra Creativity and Innovation Series here at the National Gallery of Victoria. Our guest speaker this evening is Linda Liukas, a Finnish programmer, storyteller, and illustrator. Linda's the author of Hello Ruby, a book that introduces children to technology, computing, and coding. She also founded Rails Girls, which has organized workshops in over 270 countries. And she teaches the basics of programming to more than 10,000 women through her work of Rails Girls. In 2013, Linda won the Ruby Hero Prize and was named the Digital Champion of Finland by the EU Commissioner for Digital Agenda. I hope there's a very beautiful cape that comes with that. Her TED Talk, A Delightful Way to Teach Children About Computers, has been viewed over 1.4 million times. This evening, Linda is going to share her thoughts on the impact of technology on creativity and the importance of teaching computer coding to everyone. Following the lecture, I'll be back to ask Linda some questions, and there'll be an opportunity for audience questions as well. So get those minds thinking, and please stick around, and please join me now in welcoming Linda to the stage.
Beautiful. Thank you so much for the introduction and warm welcome. I love being here in Melbourne. As mentioned, I'm a programmer, I'm an artist, I'm an illustrator, and I'm an author. I'm also a business school dropout, and the reason why three of those four identities are in parentheses is because I'm not certain about them yet. I still feel a little bit self-conscious calling myself an author or a programmer, and the only thing that I'm absolutely certain about is that I never finished business school. But that is the thing with us humans. Computers are binary. Computers can be only one thing or the other, one or zero, on or off. But we humans, we contain multitudes. We can be many things at the same time. And I think that's what makes us special. My perspective to this whole world of teaching computing and technology is this. If programming is the next lingua franca of the future, if our kids are going to learn Python and JavaScript and Ruby as their first foreign language, instead of grammar classes, we need poetry lessons. And what I mean with that, it's the same way we don't teach English by only conjugating irregular verbs or learning about different nouns or adjectives. We learn a language by using it. I learned English by reading a lot of texts in English. I learned English by writing different kinds of texts like columns and poems and letters. And even though programming is not a natural language, I think we ought to be teaching it in a multitude of different ways. So my sort of hero on this journey and my guidance has been this little girl. Her name is Ruby. She's 6 years old. She's completely fearless, a little bit bossy. And when I was learning programming myself, trying to figure out what is this object-oriented programming about, what is this garbage collection thing, all of the frustrating programming jargon I would run into, I would try to imagine how a 6-year-old little girl would explain these things. And then something switched in my brain. And you know how there's people who see numbers as colors? I started to see the world of technology through stories. And I imagined if Apple was a character, it would of course be the snow leopard who's beautiful, but doesn't want to play with the other kids because it only enjoys well-designed, beautiful things. And if Linux was a character, it would be the penguin who's really smart but somewhat hard to understand. And if Google was a character, it would be a bunch of green robots that are really friendly but almost hug us to death, and they're a little bit messy, and so forth and so forth. And I told my mom about this idea, and she's like, that sounds horrible. That sounds like a Soviet propaganda thing from the 70s. Why on earth should kids understand how these big companies think? And I'm like, yeah, but these big companies kind of define our worlds and they have very different value systems. But then I went back to the drawing board and figured that, okay, I need to think of something a little bit more profound. What if I teach kids programming before syntax? What if I teach them these thinking structures that you need even before you write your first line of programs, of a code? And that's how Hello Ruby was born. So Ruby is a small girl, and when Ruby's dad tells her, hey Ruby, where you're running late from school, you need to dress up really quickly. Ruby, see, she does dress up, but she leaves her pajamas on because dad didn't specifically tell her to take the pajamas first off. And when Ruby is told that, Ruby, your room is a mess, clean up all the toys. Ruby, she cleans the toys, but she leaves the pens and papers on the floor because dad, come on, pens and papers are not toys. And there is a chance that I'm raising the most obnoxious generation of kids ever. But they also learn something very profound about how to speak to a computer, namely that you need to be very careful when you name things. You need to give exact commands in the right order. You need to take into all sorts of situations where the code might be used. And finally, that even the biggest problems in the world are just tiny problems stuck together. And I've been working on this project for 3.5 years now, and the book has been translated into over 20 different languages. And the number one thing I've learned so far is that there is a huge demand to make computing more approachable and accessible for different kinds of learners. And beyond programming, I feel like my own thinking has advanced progressed or moved towards the idea that I'm not necessarily even teaching programming to kids. I'm preparing kids for a world where every problem is starting to look like a computer. And I'll explain this in a little bit more detail. But before that, I would like to tell you 3 stories around this idea that every problem in the world is turning into a computer. The first story is around the unlikely daughter of math and poetry. The second story is around the electricity, the moment when electricity meets logic. And the third story is around the art of abstraction. So, who is the unlikely daughter of math and poetry? It's Miss Ada Lovelace, who we today think is the world's first programmer. Ada was a lady who lived in the Victorian era England, and her mother was a mathematician, and her father was a poet, actually Lord Byron, who some of you might have studied in school. And Byron was a womanizing man. He had a lot of affairs and a lot of like messy relationships, and Ada's mom was obviously very pissed at him for the most of the time. And she said, my daughter is going to have a rigorous mathematical education, none of that poetry nonsense for her. And she did have a rigorous mathematical education for her era of a woman, but she also kept a little bit of that sense of wonder her father gave to her. And when she hung out with Charles Babbage and the crew in London who was trying to come up with the analytical engine, she was the person who saw that a computer can be so much more than a calculator. Because everyone else was obsessed with the idea of making a mechanical calculator that could calculate long series of numbers. But Ada was the one who realized that with numbers, you can represent logic. And with logic, you can represent anything in the world. And that's why we think Ada is the world's first programmer. So code is born out of the relationship between math and poetry. But for some reason, when we think about programming, we think about long series of ones and zeros. And we don't have this mental model of what does programming and code look like. And when we think about programming, we think about a programmer sitting in front of a screen who types those ones and zeros, and it's very lonely, and it's very mathematical, and it's only suitable for very introverted people. Well, in reality, programming consists of 3 parts. There's planning the program, there's writing the program in a programming language into code, and finally there's testing and debugging the program, seeing whether it worked. And only the second part is the part where you write the ones and zeros, and preferably not even those, like the actual programming code. Step number one and step number 3 are very human activities, things where it really helps that you can communicate and you can work with people and express your ideas. So programming has also advanced. We don't write the ones and zeros anymore, luckily. There's a piece of assembly code over there and a piece of Ruby code, and they both output the exact same thing. They both output the Hello World text on the computer. But during the 30 years between these 2 programming languages, a lot happened, and at least to my eyes, the Ruby programming code looks a lot more friendlier. So the programmer writes the code, and it gets compiled into the ones and zeros that the computer understands. And then the ones and zeros get shown on the screen like the thing that the computer programmer wanted to see. And I think the trick here is to understand that the computer understands the ones and the zeros, and we humans, we understand the programming language. And the trick is, how do you create your, or structure your thinking in a way that it makes sense for a computer? And the reason why all of this is so important is because programming, it isn't anymore inside of business units or only in games. It's everywhere around our society. Transportation is becoming a software industry. When you look at Uber and Lyft and so forth, governments are run with code. You can see programming in music and in neurosciences. And in order to really get to solve the kinds of problems we want to be solving and progress matters that we want to get progressed, we need to have a much more diverse body of people who think about problems they want to solve. And the sad thing is that programming, it used to be this very multidisciplinary, exciting field, and the luminaries of the programming world, they really understood all of this. They felt that programming is a wonderful way to teach you about the big ideas of science and math and intellectual model building, but we somehow lost all of this. And I think the big trick for education right now is to come up with new ways of explaining concepts behind programming and asking questions that the computer science industry doesn't traditionally ask. So one of those questions might be, how does a loop feel like? And the concept of a loop, the idea that a computer is excellent at repeating sequences of instructions over and over again, it doesn't need coffee breaks, the computer's kids are never sick. It can go on and on doing these repetitive, mundane, stupid tasks that humans don't really excel at if you give it good enough instructions. Starts in Ruby's world by having a dance party. So Ruby's favorite dance move is this. It goes like clap, clap, stomp, stomp, clap, clap, and jump. And the kids learn about a for loop, the idea that you can repeat a loop a certain amount of time by repeating this sequence of dance movements 5 times. And they learn about while loops, the idea that you repeat the sequence while a condition is true by repeating the dance movements while I'm standing on one leg. And finally, they learn about the until loop, the idea that you repeat a sequence until the condition is met by going home and repeating the dance move until mom gets really, really frustrated with them. And in this way, we move through the different abstraction layers of programming. Maybe first the kids start with a kinetic expression of like, what does a loop feel like? Then they advance into a visual programming language like Scratch. Maybe then they fiddle with code and see what the coding and the syntax might look like. And most importantly, we need to give them examples of where do you see the loops in the wild. For instance, when you go on a website and you type in your password and you type it 3 times wrong and the whole account gets locked, that's a loop. There's a loop that says that allow the user to repeat this password 3 times and then lock the account. Or if you're playing a video game, there's a character or the hero, and there's a loop that says, move the hero onwards until it hits an enemy. And I didn't know this when I got started with this whole thing, but there's a word and there's a whole academic discipline behind this thinking of how do we structure our way of thinking in a way that it makes sense for a computer. And it's called computational thinking. And it includes concepts like decomposition, taking a problem and putting it into smaller pieces, algorithms, building a step-by-step sequence to solve a problem, abstraction, data, automation. But almost more importantly, it includes practices like persistency, like tinkering, like collaboration, like debugging your code. I can't even count the amount of times when I've had little girls come to me and said that, Linda, I'm so bad at programming. And I go and see their code together and I say, yo, no, you're not bad. Like, you just forgot one semicolon. Like, even the best programmers in the world, they forgot semicolons every single day. And in their cases, it's like $500,000 worth of semicolons when you have 9 senior engineers trying to spot the missing semicolon. And persistency and mistake making and debugging is an integral part of programming. You're doing it absolutely right. So programming is one thing, giving instructions to a computer, but what is a computer? And this was kind of the big next question that started to interest me, because we talked a lot about programming, but we talked very little about what is a computer then. And this is kind of the broad story of the next Ruby book that is coming out in Australia in October. And it starts with Ruby going to Dad's room, and she knows she's not supposed to be on his computer. She types the password in there, but the password doesn't work. And the white mouse next to the computer wakes up and says, "Oh, Ruby, I can't find the cursor. The cursor has gone missing. Can you help me out?" And Ruby says, "Of course, I'm the best computer doctor there is. I'll help you out." And together they make themselves very small and they crawl inside the computer and fall until they meet the electricity and the bits. But the bits are not very helpful. They can be only one way or the other way, and you need eight of them in order to make any sense of them. And they move on to the next layer of computers, which is the logic gates. And logic gates, they can only say true or false, and they are not very helpful in this quest to find the missing cursor. And they move on, and they meet the bossy CPU, the hardware layer of computers. And the CPU is very good at giving instructions, but it's very bad at remembering things, so they need to move on to meet the operating system, and so on and so on, and they do finally meet the cursor. I'm not going to spoil the end result for you, but throughout this journey, they go through the whole abstraction layer of a computer, from the lowest level of electricity to the highest level of apps. And the beautiful thing about computers is that we don't need to care about the electricity level anymore, but that's also the bad thing about computers. We have these beautiful, powerful devices, these glowing boxes, but we have no idea how they work anymore. We have no ownership over them. We can't open our modern Macs anymore or understand how they work. And sort of reclaiming our relationship with technology and computers is, I think, one of the most important things this generation will have to do. Sometimes I ask kids to imagine what is inside of a computer. And for adults, this is a very hard task. Adults say, "Oh, I don't have a PhD in computer science. I can't answer this question." But the thing I love about kids is that they start with a hypothesis. They come up with something, and usually this something is the beginning of a really interesting discussion. And I have kids who describe the insides of a computer through the metaphor of content creation. They show me apps and files that are inside of a computer, and they are, to some extent, right. There's kids who see computers as these abstract connections of networks and elements that are interconnected. They are right too. Then there's kids who see the computer as a metaphor, for instance, as a theater or a stage where the different components come and talk to one another, and the bugs physically carry out functions from one part of the computer to another. That's a wonderful way of explaining what a computer is. There's even kids who see computers as hardware, as this like steampunkish gear thing where there's like little interlocking gears that go on. And they have grasped something about the mechanical aspects of computers too. No gears inside there, but a lot of like small movements, bits that go on and off. And then there's my favorite kids, the drafters, the kids who somehow intuitively understand that computers might be magical, but they are not magic. Computers are based on logic. Computers are based on components talking to one another. There's electricity, and there's connections inside of a computer. The next thing we do is we build computers out of paper, and the kids get to first cut out the different parts of the computer. They get to know and recognize the bossy CPU and the RAM and ROM that help it remember things. They get to choose an operating system. We live in a very Mac-centric world. It's almost scary. They get to design their own keyboard and own special keys for the keyboard, and then they get to design their own first applications. And it's very interesting. The first thing the kids do, they usually make Angry Birds, and they remember so well all of the details of these games that they play. But when you push them a little bit further, you start to see some very exciting results. So I had this little boy who came to me, and he had built an intergalactic planetary navigation application. And the boy has these huge headphones on, and he's completely immersed in his very own paper computer. And the boy's father is the astronaut who's far away in the Martian orbit, but really on the other side of the room. And the boy's important task is to bring father back safely home on Earth with his own computer device and app. And I think that kid is going to have a profoundly different experience of what it means to create with a computer and what it means to have a relationship with technology. So when I need to explain to kids what a computer really is, I need to go all the way back to the year 1945 and to a certain Mr. John von Neumann, who was a scientist who came up with the architecture we still use around computers every day. And John von Neumann would explain, a computer is any device where you put in data, you do something with the data, and output the modified data. And this is true when you go on Facebook and you like a post in there, in goes the data to Facebook servers, that there's one more like count, and out comes the added like count to the post. But it's also true when you sit in your car and you forgot to lock your seatbelt, and in goes the data that someone is sitting in the car and the seatbelt is not locked. There's a program that knows that, hey, we should warn the passenger at this point, and out comes the beep, 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 beep. That is so annoying. And the thing that makes a computer so magical is the memory. Computers have two types of memory. They have the memory that remembers the data that comes in and the modified data that goes out. But they have the type of memory where you write the instructions on what to do with that data. And that's what we call code. And it's the software who writes that code. And it's what makes computers so special. Because a pinball machine can only be a pinball machine. A tractor can be only a tractor, but a computer can be anything based on the instructions you give for it. And usually at this point, the kids are already pretty restless and like, let's do something. So we build a paper computer out of cardboard, and some of the kids are the input data. They crawl inside of the computer. They see a little piece of code inside of it, like come out jumping on one leg, and they come out, and the other kids need to debug and decode what kind of code was there. And the computer goes round and round and round, and they learn through this very physical activity what input, memory, output really is about. And the computer usually breaks by the end of this session. So, after having this real, again, that tangible experience of what a computer is, the kids go on, and I show them four pictures. And this is a hard exercise for parents, too. I show them a picture of a car, a grocery store, a dog, and a toilet. And I ask the kids, which one of these do you think is a computer? And the kids all look at me like I'm, like, totally bonkers. And they say, Linda, that is a stupid question. None of those is a computer. The computer is the glowing box in front of which mom or dad spends way too much time. But then we talk, and we discover that actually a car is a computer because it has a navigation system. A grocery store has all sorts of computers inside of it. There's burglar alarms, and there's the ice cream machine that keeps the ice cream cold. A dog is not a computer, but there's robot dogs, and a dog's collar might have a computer inside of it. And don't do this with your kids, but I tell them that in Japan, toilets are computers, and there's even hackers who hack them, and that's the end of the discussion for the rest of the day. Nothing else can get done after that. So we discover that actually computer is not only the glowing box, that there's probably 100 different computers in every single home, because your microwave is a computer and your remote controller is a computer. And the next step in this exercise is one where I give kids these little on-off stickers, a little sticker with an on-off button on it, and I tell them that for this afternoon alone, you can make anything in this room into a computer by sticking this little sticker on it. Like, I have keys and a book and some canned food. And again, the kids, they say, that's too hard. Like, I don't know the right answer for this task. And I tell them, like, neither does your parent. Like, they might have heard about this thing called the Internet of Things or the IoT, but you guys are going to be the ones who grow up in a world where your teddy bear is a computer and your toothbrush is a computer, and it's kind of up to you to design that world. So I have this little girl who comes to me with a bicycle lamp, and she goes, Linda, if this bicycle lamp were a computer, we could go on a biking trip with my father, and we could sleep in a tent, and then this bicycle lamp could also be a movie projector. And that's the moment I'm looking for. Not the moment when the kid writes the perfect if-else statement, or when they understand the differences between hashes and arrays in Ruby. The moment when they understand three very profound things that even us adults have a hard time understanding. First of them is that the world is not ready yet. There's so much we haven't invented or discovered. Bicycle lamp, movie projector being maybe not the most important one, but like that doesn't exist still. The second thing the little girl discovered was that technology is a wonderful way to make the world a little bit more ready because it scales and it creates wealth wherever it goes. And the third thing she discovered is that she herself can be a part of that change. Odds are that she's not going to be the first bicycle lamp movie projector inventor, but for a moment she had the self-agency and self-belief to think that, yeah, like, I could do that, I could totally be that person. And I think that's what we ought to be sort of safeguarding in childhood and maybe also within us adults. The thing I'm trying to get across to kids nowadays is sort of the concept of a notional machine. The idea that in order to survive in the future, the kids ought to have a very robust understanding of what a computer is good at and what a human is good at. And it includes asking a lot of hard questions like, can a computer be creative? Do computers have feelings? Can computers make art? And asking questions and comparing us to, like, what are humans good at, what are humans bad at, what kind of tasks computers are good at, what are they bad at, and these tend to become very philosophical, almost ethical discussions. And for kids who have this very robust idea of what a notional machine is, they are not scared about the future. They are not scared about artificial intelligence coming in and swooping all the jobs because they really know that it's us humans who control all of it. They understand that if you have an input of a picture and you have a program that recognizes are there human faces, the output is just a list of, like, whether there are human faces or not, and the application for that might be photo tagging. They know that if you have car cameras, their input is all of the photos of the surrounding position of other cars, and the output is a map of those cars, and the application for that might be self-driving cars. They have an understanding of what artificial intelligence might look like, what computers are good at, and where they will never excel at. And one of my favorite activities is this art and algorithm exercise where each of the kids gets their own algorithm. And we adults have a very frustrated and frightened relationship with the word algorithm. It's like we think about finances and we think about scary big things, but actually kids really like the word algorithm. It's a big adult word and it sounds funny in your mouth, and they love getting their own algorithms. And most importantly, they know that algorithm is just a step-by-step step-by-step solution to solving a problem. So one kid's algorithm might be to draw red circles. Another kid's algorithm might be to draw a blue dot inside each red circle. The third kid's algorithm might be to connect all the blue dots with a yellow line. And when I turn the computer on, the kids go round and round and round the big piece of paper. And this is a very fast computer, and it takes us roughly 20 minutes to create this beautiful big artwork. And we all stand behind it, and we observe, and we look at it, and we're all very happy with ourselves. And I ask the kids, how long do you think it would take a computer to digitally create an artwork like this if it was given the exact same instructions? And the kids say, I think at least an hour, because we worked together and we were really fast. And I tell them that, you know what, it would probably take a nanosecond for a computer to generate like 100 million of these, because these are exactly the kinds of tasks a computer is really good at. It can follow instructions really fast and generate a lot of copies. And the kids are disappointed. But then I ask them, how does this artwork make you feel? And one of the little kids goes and says, oh, this artwork makes me feel very busy. And the other one says, oh, it makes me feel somewhat happy. And I say to them, like, this is the thing that a computer can't do. It can't have a perception about artwork. It can't have feelings and emotions around artwork. It can go on Wikipedia and probably, like, download an article about abstract, like abstractionism or cubism or whatnot, but it can never sort of experience those feelings itself. And the exciting thing is that these things are fluid, these things are changing, because we are starting to be able to help computers recognize things in the world. So, like, the current AIs, the very sort of narrow AIs Google, for instance, is building, computers are starting to be able to recognize cats from YouTube videos, a thing that a six-year-old can do, but computer scientists are like, whoa, what a leap in artificial intelligence! Because you see, like, cats come in all different sizes and shapes. It's a really hard task for a computer to recognize the Garfield, the cartoon cat, as a cat, and also the blue cat with no ears, and things that a six-year-old can do, a computer is not really good at doing. But the ability to recognize is the first step to be able to generate. And the first step after you can generate things is to have a perception around the about the world. And I think computers will have some sort of creativity. I don't know, think we know yet what that creativity will look like. And I think it's going to be up to David Hockney to like figure out what the questions we ought to be asking from artificial intelligence look like in order to see what computer creativity looks like as opposed to human creativity. This is a very, very interesting time to be alive. Final short story, Art of Abstraction. So one of my favorite pedagogists is Jean Piaget, who was sort of a very early innovator around math education and many, many other things. And one of his big points was that we are, when especially when teaching math, we are giving kids these pre-organized vocabularies and concepts, but rather like the best kind of learning environment is grounded in action. And that's why you see so many of the best programmers of today, they don't come from universities, they are self-learned, they are people who were driven by their own passion. And I think one of the most important things in education we can give to kids nowadays is the ability to ask and form questions that they find themselves interesting and worth pursuing, because the time of the memorization is over. The computer can remember things for us, and we can access that memory through Google or whatnot, but a computer is not very good at asking questions yet. And where I find most sort of advice and help on this journey to figure out what kind of questions the kids ought to be asking, it comes from a tiny Italian village. It's a village called Reggio Emilia, where they came up roughly 80 years ago with something very special and interesting. After the Second World War, the Italians discovered that we have basically wrecked a whole generation of kids, what with the war and the like fascism and so forth, and they figured out they need a whole different way of educating kids. So they came up with the concept of school as an atelier and a teacher as an atelierista, and the whole sort of idea behind this Reggio Emilia school is boiled down in this poem. And the philosophy is not a manual, it's a poem that summarizes the thinking in the school. And the idea is that the Reggio people believe that the child has 100 languages. The child has the language of painting, the child has the language of sculpting, the child has the language of crawling. But we adults tend to say that, oh, like you only need 2 languages. You need the language of reading and writing. And we steal those 99 languages. And we tell them that reality and fantasy and science and imagination, they don't go together, and the child has 100 languages. And I believe that Loris Malaguzzi, who was the founder of this Reggio movement, if he lived today, he would totally see programming as one of the 100 languages of the child. And one of the Reggio prompts I really like is, instead of asking the kids this big question like, how would you make the world a better place, Reggio asks kids, how could you make an amusement park for the birds who come to visit our school? And the kids start by observing the birds, and then they maybe CAD-modeled amusement park in a computer, and they learn to classify different birds, and they learn about mechanical engineering and architecture. And this is what I mean when I say that it's very important to teach kids to come up with good questions, and programming is one of the languages the kid can use to explore these things. So one of the kids I've worked with, he's a little boy, and he came really, really obsessed with this idea of what is the world's most dangerous animal? And he went to Google and Googled this question, and Google told him that the world's most dangerous animal is a snake that is 3 kilometers long. And I asked him, are you sure? Like, we're not in Australia, right? Like, can Google lie to you? And he thinks, and we go back and we observe the site and realize that it was a joke. Like, there's no such thing as a 3 kilometer long snake. So he first learns about media literacy. But he's very interested in this 3 kilometer long snake as a concept. So he draws it first out, but he realizes that pen and paper are not the way to really make it alive and visible. So he goes on to Scratch, which is a visual programming language for kids, and he creates the 3 kilometer long snake, and he makes it move. And because Scratch is such a wonderful language, instead of one snake, he can multiply the snakes in all the colors of the rainbow, and he can make tiny snakes and big snakes, and it all starts with him having a very profound and almost obsessive interest with this idea of the world's most dangerous animal. I think this is what programming, art education, playfulness should look like. And in the same way as a biologist uses a pipette as a tool to study the world, the same way as a physicist uses a prism, a computer scientist uses programming as a tool to study the world. But the difference here is that when we hear someone say that, oh, I'm a biologist, we think that, oh, they study the biological world. And when we hear someone say that I'm a physicist, we understand that they study the physical world. But when we hear someone say, I'm a computer scientist, we think that they study the computer. And that's wrong. The computer scientist uses the computer and programming and many other tools to study the world, and a world where more and more of the problems we see around us are turning into computer problems. I'm going to wrap up here because I know we're almost out of time. I think we forget that humans are not binary. We forget that the very roots of technology are in humanity, and that a computer used to be actually a person. Being a computer used to be a profession, much like being a teacher or a doctor. In the Victorian era England, where Ada Lovelace lived, being a computer was a person who calculated long series of numbers. And in some ways, I believe that the very last humans will be computers too. And technology as a word, it comes from Greek, and it means tools to solve problems. But it also means the techniques and skills and competencies, all very humane things that us humans bring into the equation. Technology is profoundly built on humanity. We adults forget this, but the kids don't. I surveyed a bunch of 9-year-olds in Helsinki and asked them to define to me what is technology, who uses it, and what is it used for. And my favorite answer is this. This little girl says, technology is electricity that loves. Is there a more poetic, beautiful way? Technology is electricity that loves. It is used to play. I use it to have a conversation with my mom. We use a WhatsApp application. And then finally, and most importantly, people use technology. Thank you very much.
Well, Linda, thank you very much for taking us on this journey into the wild, as you see technology and computers and programming. It hasn't always been this way with technology education. I wondered if you could look back and think of the first time that you were taught how to program and what that looked like for you.
So the first time I really felt powerful with a computer was when I was 7 years old and my dad brought us home a computer. And this was like the beginning of the 90s, and it was like a laptop which must have cost a fortune at the time, and it was this big bulky thing. But my dad, who was trained as a programmer actually, but did his whole career in finance, he told us kids that, like, you can't do anything with the computer that can't be undone. And notice here that this was the time before Dropbox. This was the time before, like, automatic version controls or like cloud whatevers. And we wiped the operating system a few times while we absolutely destroyed the computer. But then my father had the patience to work with us through and sort of like figure out how to make the computer work again. And as a consequence, I got a very fearless attitude towards computers. But my first experience with school and computers was when I took AP Computer Science in high school. And the first task was to write a program that calculates the square roots of the first 20 prime numbers.
Oh, your teachers must be cringing right now.
Yeah, and it works for certain types of learners, absolutely. Certain types of learners were so, like, pumped about this task, and like, kudos to them. But I think computer science education traditionally has been geared too much towards those types of learners, and it's time to open it up for all kinds.
So you were fortunate to have, you know, family access to the technology. What sort of questions do you get from parents who are around the kids that you're teaching?
So I think a lot of people here in this room already have drunk the Kool-Aid of, like, programming is important, my kid needs to learn to program. And last summer we did this summer school experiment in Helsinki, and the whole idea was to teach computational thinking. And for the first 3 days we didn't have any computers, like no screens. We learned about the concept of an algorithm, of bubble sort and inversion sort and merge sort, through, like, organizing the kids in lines and them becoming the data that was being organized according to the algorithm. But then the parents came to me and said, but when is the real programming starting? Like, when are they going to actually do the programming? I'm like, they have been doing it all along. And then I caved in and brought in the computers. But I think that is the one thing that parents ought to understand, is that you can learn a lot of these concepts without adding any more screen time to your kids' regimen. And computer science is a thinking skill. It's a lot more than dragging and dropping like different pieces together.
That is something I wanted to ask about, actually. It's quite topical at the moment. People are concerned about whether a certain proportion of screen time at various ages might be good or bad for their children, and whether it might have an impact on developmental delays. What age are the kids that you're putting in front of screens, and do the parents sort of express any concerns about this screen time issue?
So my approach has been pretty much like unplugged, which is a way of saying that we don't use screens. We, like, a lot of people ask me why a book, like, isn't a book a very ancient form of teaching in this era of like interactive iPad applications? But I think there is something about storytelling. There's something about books that we as like humanity understand really well, and there's something beautiful about that. And as you mentioned, like, the kids are being bombarded with screen time all along. So it's a little bit too of an easy of an answer. That being said, I think we should look into the mirror. Like, when parents come to me and say, like, how much screen time should my kid have? Like how much screen time do you have? Like, how often do you put your, like, phone away? And like, I am the first to admit that they are addiction machines. Like,
it is a very tough love school you're running there.
Yeah, it's hard to put it away. So I think it starts also with the parent, like, helping kids.
Well, I hope that the audience has been thinking about some questions, because we do have some mics around. Maybe if you could sort of flag if you've got some questions, and then after the next one, we'll sort of open up and see. Now, we can't ignore the fact that you're a Finnish programmer and storyteller. In relation to growing up with Scandinavian stories, you once said, it's not a coincidence that so much of the open source works of the world, like Linux, Git, SSH, IRC, MySQL, PHP, Rails, comes from the northern latitudes.
It's 30 million people, roughly. So Finland is 5 million people, and the Scandinavian region, which we technically don't belong to, but culturally do, is 30 million people. And it's unproportionate amount of open source.
So when you alluded to maybe the stories that you were told as children and how that might have led to a compatibility of a really vibrant open source community, what do you think it was that was native to the stories that that might have inculcated that value system?
So I think it goes down to the societal level. So we, as a sort of social welfare systems, the strong belief in sort of government helping and supporting people, like very long maternity leaves, good like job protection, the idea that we are all in this together. Finland used to be a very poor country until like 100 years ago. We went from, or like less than that even, we went from being a very agrarian, like poor country into one of the best countries in the world. And I think it goes to that track record of societal change where like we want to help one another out. And that's where the storytelling culture comes from. That's where the technology culture comes from. The idea that we help one another out. And it also helps that we have horrible winters, so you don't have anything fun to do. You sit inside and code.
So you've joked about Australia having, you know, terrible big snakes and things. Do you think that maybe something about a hostile environment might encourage some radical thinking there?
Maybe. I think it's a very important aspect to understand that, like, education and culture go highly hand in hand. So I was very gung-ho in the past about, like, yes, let's disrupt education. Let's, like, why do things happen so slowly? And as I've gotten older, I've started to really appreciate the fact that educational systems don't change too fast. And I travel a lot. I've worked with a lot in US and in Japan and in Germany, and everyone ask me, so how should we bring coding to the curriculum? And it's, listen, like, it depends what kind of citizens you want to come out of the end of the funnel, and what works for Finland might not work for other countries. And it's fairly important to have that discussion as a country of, like, how do we want to be teaching these things.
Absolutely. All right, have we got some questions that are starting to come up?
I was just wondering, like, in your travels, what kind of has really gotten you excited? What kind of examples have you seen of young people using technology and creativity drawn together to solve social problems? Like, what kind of solutions have you seen that have gotten you really excited?
So one country that I've been very excited about is Australia. I'm not saying this because I'm here. It goes back to the idea that like educational systems need to understand their legacy and background where they come from. So for UK, it makes sense that they have a separate subject called computing because they are the country who gave us Ada Lovelace and Tim Berners-Lee and Alan Turing, and they have this strong like legacy of these like computing heroes. And for them it works. But what I've been really impressed with Australia is the fact that you've decided to bring this sort of very creative approach to computing, this very multidisciplinary, like what little I've understood from friends who work here in the educational system. And I'm almost like hesitant to give you examples because I don't think we've yet seen the people who will make that change. And I can imagine what the sort of world of computing will look like when we invite the 99% of the people who haven't been so far a part of it into creating the future. But in all honesty, like I would allow their work to speak for them. So I'm very excited to see when David Hockney ditches the iPad and starts to program and express himself through programming, or like the work that Björk, the singer-songwriter, is doing, like what she will come up with, or like the scientists and the kindergarten teachers, or the biologists, like when they themselves can define, when they have the tools to sort of create what they see in their own world, or in their own head. That's what's going to get me really excited.
Great. Any more questions at the moment? One over here.
Hi. I was just wondering, how do we get this message out to like parents and adults who may not understand it as much as... Because I know as teenagers, we can understand this a lot more as we've grown up like this. But how do we get this message out to adults and parents who may not understand it?
You have a lot of different rhetoric around it. You use different words for different people. For some people, you talk about job creation and GDP growth. And for some people, you talk about the artistic expression. And you just use a lot of different ways to persuade people. And I think it's very important that I was very hesitant about the whole like role model thing, and I said like, oh, I'm still a very mediocre programmer. I don't know if I should be standing here on stage talking about these issues. But I realized the exact same thing, that we need to have more different kinds of voices to speak about this thing. So I decided, okay, I'm going to learn how to speak publicly and talk about these issues, because they are too important to be left only for, say, the politicians or the like the people who run big companies or so forth. We need those voices, of course, too, but I think you yourself, you can go tomorrow to a school and explain to the principal that this is important, or like organize an after-school program for kids in the neighborhood. And that's how change, I think, really happens, when you have a lot of different voices telling essentially the same message, but with different words.
There's one over here.
Hi. In the last couple of weeks, Mark Cuban, the technology entrepreneur, came out and said that the real skills that kids will have in the future are creative and critical thinking skills, because coding is something that will be automated, will be sort of automating the automation, if you like. So I just wondered what your thoughts were on that.
How many programmers in the room? A few. How many of you feel like computers will generate better code than you do? Yeah, a few, but most of them don't. So I think a lot of these people who tell these things think that programming is a rote skill, that it's a mechanical monkey work, whereas like people who've actually programmed a lot know that there's a lot of problem solving. It's more of a craft in many ways. And when we look at the code, like how we went from assembly code, the really complicated looking, long and cumbersome code, into Ruby code, which is beautiful and elegant and simple, I do think that there's going to be a lot of things that are going to happen in the future that will make programming easier, but it's still going to require a lot of human thinking skills and problem solving skills, decomposition skills, essentially the computational thinking skills, and it's going to be a long while before computers are going to code themselves. So I think at least the next generation, if not even the second generation after that, is going to be still programming a lot of the things in a similar fashion that as we do today. Also, I think interesting is that when you look at technology, it changes really rapidly, but programming is actually more akin to linguistics and more like more of a language, and we can actually see sort of the progression within programming for the past 70 years. And it's not exponential in the same way as, say, like the amount of like transistors in a CPU. That is exponential, but programming has more to do with problem solving and very human activities, so it changes also much slower than the sort of technological change.
And there was one more over here.
You talked before about how big business can often shape what happens. They steer sort of society, if you like. I know a few people that work in Silicon Valley that often talk about the ideas and the apps that you see are the ones that win the grants or the rapture of the venture capitalists. I was interested in your thoughts on these big businesses, big decision makers, people with money, et cetera. How can we shape the right environment in order to really enable the sorts of really exciting, creative and societally changing thought that you're talking about?
It's a very interesting question. And I worked for a while at a startup, but I left because I felt that the most scalable change, which the VCs and the startups are often after, happens when you're 6 years old. And it's as simple as that. If we can affect the childhood and the children, we can change the world, and that's scalable change. And it changed my perception of what I want to spend my time on. And now I feel like I'm at the same crossroads where I'm starting to feel like my work has more to do with the art world than with the sort of education world. So I have no idea where I'll end up with my own career. The question, how do we empower people to for the societal change instead of the VCs? Well, I think it goes down to also understanding that companies are made of people, and they have different value systems, they have different structures of driving progress, and it's no company has been around forever. When you think about how people were so bullish about Netscape back in the days, and there hasn't been Netscape for ages anymore, and these things come and go, and by raising new generations of kids who have a different framework of thinking, not a framework of thinking about returns or losses or only growth and retention, but also thinking about sort of more systemic problems, asking the good questions, how can we build an amusement park for birds? I think we're going to have a new kind of generation of business leaders as well. But again, I'm a storyteller, I'm not a macroeconomist, so what do I know?
Linda, it warms my heart to hear anybody describe code as elegant at any point. I wonder, have you ever asked the kids in your workshops to look at the code and tell you how that made them feel?
That's a wonderful exercise. I haven't, but yeah, I should. I do quite a bit of testing with kids, and a lot of people ask how do you get your ideas? And I'm very honest, I get all of them from the kids. it's just a big privilege to be able to work with kids day in and day out. And for instance, now I'm working on the third book, which is going to be about how the internet works. So I asked kids to draw what the internet is about, and that's kind of this explorative back and forth relationship we have, and they inspire me quite a bit, yeah. So I'll definitely try that one out.
Good evening, everyone. I too echo Tony's earlier acknowledgement and pay my respects to traditional owners of the land that we're meeting and gathering on tonight, the people of the Kulin Nation, and I pay my respects to elders past and present. Just reflecting on that for a moment, we're tonight meeting in a place where innovation, art, creative problem solving has been fundamental to life skills for almost 80,000 years. It's a brilliant legacy that continues today. And tonight, our friend from Finland, a distance some 15,000 kilometers as the crow flies, zoomed us into the future. A future where software is eating almost all aspects of our life, underpinned by a new language that we call code. On behalf of the NGV, Telstra, and I'm sure all of you here tonight, Linda, thank you so much for your wonderful contribution to the Telstra Creativity and Innovation Series. The NGV and Telstra have partnered because we both share a really deep curiosity about genuine commitment to explore this intersection of tech, innovation, and art. Tonight, you made that intersection dance. I think what you've done is painted a truly, truly inspiring picture of that crossroad, what it looks like now, and perhaps even more importantly, what it could look like, which I think is the key. and it's really exciting. Tonight you reminded me, and hopefully all of us, to remain curious about the 21st century materials that we have available at our fingertips to express ourselves, code and computational thinking. You've asked us to consider how coding and programming can be more accessible to everybody, so there's just greater diversity in how we express imagination. And most of all, I think you've reminded us not to think of code as a techie thing, a geeky thing, but to understand that it's written by human beings, for human beings, so it's really profoundly human, and I think that's really critical. So thank you for your wonderful insights, Linda, for sharing your stories about the great kids you work with. I love that story about the park for the birds. And thank you for taking us on a really fun leap. A future generation that grows up thinking about technology as something that you don't just consume, but that you can create with, that's really, really fantastic. And thanks to Vanessa, fantastic moderation and herding the cats tonight. So in closing, on behalf of Tony Elwood, his wonderful NGV team, and Telstra, could I ask you to please join me in thanking again the brilliant, inspiring, hopeful, and very energy-giving Linda Liukas. Thank you so much.